Smith's dude looks like a lady and he's going around the house. It's so funny. I would do it for you, but I don't want to. I don't want to take anything away from the movie. But nannies are something that are pretty common in our culture. It's something that we understand the role of a nanny or someone whom we entrusted our children to. Someone who's going to be there when they wake up, it's going to take care of the child and guide them and direct them and sometimes correct them and scold them, but sometimes also teach them and love them. And we understand this kind of idea of what it means to be a nanny. There's a couple of movies, actually, that have nannies in them. More popular would be like Mary Poppins. You remember Mary Poppins? Or even Sound of Music? Yeah, the best nanny in the world, dancing around the hills. Well, you know, the ancient Greek world, they had a very similar kind of person, a person who watches over the youth, usually in a more wealthy family. That person was called a pedagogos. And this pedagogos had the same role. They would watch over the young baby until they turned into a young adult. And they would be responsible for all the things of making sure that that child was safe and well-educated and trained and all sorts of different great things. And so this idea of the nanny or the pedagogos is what Paul is using in his letter to the Galatians. He said, so the law was our guardian until Christ came. Now that this faith has come, we're no longer under a guardian. We're no longer under a disciplinarian. We're no longer under a nanny. We're no longer under a schoolmaster or even a tutor. Now that faith has come to us in Jesus Christ. Because you see, it used to be for the Greeks, the way they practiced their faith was by upholding the law. They followed all the rules and the regulations that the Mosaic law put forth for them. There was ways to wash your hands, and there was the time to do it, and there was food to eat and food you should not eat, and there was the way you presented yourself to the temple, and if you didn't, you couldn't go to church, and there are people on the street you could not speak with because they were unclean or something different, and you couldn't relate to people. You couldn't marry people who were outside. There was all of these rules that we had. And there were rules to help us. Just like on the streets today, we have rules so we don't crash into one another. There were rules to help us through our faith. And Paul's trying to figure out, how do I tell people that things are different? How do we tell people that once Jesus Christ is revealed into your life, things are different? You are no longer tomorrow the person that you were yesterday. You are a brand new creature in Christ. How do we get that idea across? And Paul says, well, it's like a nanny. All the times you had someone watching over you and guiding you and picking you up and telling you the right things and the wrong things, that was the law. But you no longer need that. Because now you've been bathed in the baptismal waters. You've transferred yourself into a whole new family. It's like as if it happens all of a sudden, too. You know, Paul doesn't say, well, you know, gradually you'll sort of work into it. No, Paul says it happens to you, you know, like bam! You were once under the law, and now you are under faith as part of Christ's new family. Now, of course, this doesn't mean that because there was no law that you could just do whatever you wanted. He said, Paul said, we understand that, right? Even when children leave the pedagogos, they now are responsible adults. And we act within the parameters of the law. But it's more important to understand that now we are bathed in a new faith, part of a new family. He even goes so far as to say, before, when you were washed, it didn't just simply wash you clean, it clothed you with adult wardrobe. You are now part of a new family. Well, as this was happening, and as people were in the Jordan River, and they were being baptized with Jesus, and as thousands of people are coming to Christ, can you imagine how quickly this family was growing? I mean, larger than any Thanksgiving table you've been at, right? It just keeps bursting and bursting. And Paul says, you know, it's not just a matter of you being baptized. It's a matter of all believers being baptized. That means we are no longer under the law. That means we are one in Christ. That means that you and I, that were formerly separated by the law because perhaps you lived on the other side of town, or you had a different skin color, or you had a different upbringing, or you were from a different economic class, he says that no longer matters. Because now we are all one great big family sitting here beside the Jordan River. We are unified in one Christ Jesus. I'd like to read to you the same passage again from Galatians, but I'd like to read to you in a different translation. This comes from the Message Bible, and it uses words that maybe could ring better in our ears. Until the time when we were mature enough to respond freely in faith to our living God, we were carefully surrounded and protected by the Mosaic law. The law was kind of like those Greek tutors or nannies with which you are very familiar. They escort children to school, and they protect them from danger or distraction. They make sure that children will get to where they're going without harm. But now you have arrived at your destination. By faith in Christ, you are in direct relationship with God. Your baptism in Christ was not just washing you with water, it also involved dressing you as an adult, putting on a new wardrobe. Christ's life is now on you. And it's the fulfillment of God's original promise. Because you see, in Christ's family, there can be no division. There is no Jew and non-Jew. There's no slave or free. There's no male or female. Among all of you, you are equal. That is, we're all on the same page. We're all in common relationship with Jesus Christ. And since you are now Christ's family, then guess what? You are Abraham's famous descendants. You are heirs to the promise of God. You are going to receive eternal life. So whatever physical, social, economic, cultural, language difference that there may have been, those things no longer have any value in life. All the new culture is for those who have been baptized into Christ and clothed with Christ. And they are called unified. Baptized believers receive a whole new identity, says Paul, a whole new way of life. I think of it more like this in our kind of 2018 language. No more can we use first world and third world people of the globe. We are people of the globe. No more are we city dwellers and rural farmers. No more are we executives and laborers. No more are we the young or the old. No more are we black, brown, white, or any other color. No more are we healthy or sick. No more are we a native or an immigrant. We are sons and daughters of Christ. Now I know some of these differences are really apparent to our eyes and maybe even to our ears, but Paul is telling us that no longer even matters. There's no longer any value in that because we are all heirs according to God's original promise. And when I think of that, I get so excited that we are all now part of this family. We're joined together. We are brothers and sisters in Christ, and I know what that means. It's like the best Thanksgiving dinner ever with your entire family. But then I can't help but pause and think about how sad that makes me at the same time. Because I look around the world and I think, have we done it? I mean, since the baptism of Jesus Christ and since the baptism of every single person in this room, have we done it? Have we rid ourselves of division? Have we rid ourselves of racial hatred in the world? Have we rid ourselves of division over wealth and poverty? I wonder which lives truly matter in this world, the black or the blue? If we look around and we're truly honest with ourselves, we have failed. And we have failed miserably in this world. Our world, our neighborhoods, our local community, and even our church has pockets of division that go against one another, that clash against one another, that fight against one another. I think we've failed. And I know that the law of Moses is unable to save us. So what are we going to do? How are we going to live out this commandment of being brothers and sisters in Christ and there to be no division, no separation between us? We need help. And that help can only come from Jesus himself. In Romans chapter 7, Paul, he describes his own personal struggle with this as well. Paul says, I know the good I'm supposed to do, but I can't do it. And I know the bad that I'm supposed to avoid, but I keep doing that. How many times have you asked a young child, why did you do it? And they say, I don't know. How many times have you yourself said something and wished you could have pulled it back? How many times have you wished, when you look back over your life, I wish I hadn't done that, and that, because I knew better? And other times when you thought, I wish I had done this, and this. And so as Paul is praying in Romans chapter 7, he says, who will rescue me from myself? And then he ends this way. He says, thanks be to God. Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord, I will be saved. I will be saved. In the same way, you and I, we struggle like this every day, don't we? We know the good we're supposed to do, but for some reason we don't do it. And we know the things we're not supposed to say that hurt other people and the actions that we do, and yet we still do them. Well, you've been baptized. And maybe we all need to remember what that means for each and every one of us. We've been brought into the family of the church. But then I look at the church and I think, who's going to rescue the church? It's filled with broken people saying hurtful things out into this world. Who's going to rescue the church? And then Paul says, thanks be to God. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, we will all be saved for those who believe and are baptized. If we're to become more unified, If we're to live more as a unified family in this world, we need to look beyond ourselves. We need to look beyond our differences, even though they're right in our face, and sometimes we see them and sometimes we hear them. We need to go beyond that and look at the same thing we all look at. Our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the One. Not a traditional Christ, not a contemporary Christ, not a three-prayer Christ, not an intinction Christ, not a communion at the rail Christ, not a Christ in robes, not a Christ in jeans. Jesus Christ. The one and only Christ. The one who called each and every one of you to be part of this family. One family. A unified family. You ever heard the old adage, blood is thicker than water? Paul says that's not entirely true. There's something else that's thicker than blood in biology. And that's the water of baptism. That's thicker than blood. The water of baptism forms within us a closer bond than anything else that we will ever experience. It brings us into a whole new family when God imparts his grace to us when we are baptized. Baptism water is thicker than blood, and we are then joined together. And that's a bond that cannot be broken. So what do we do? to look to Jesus. Jesus as our example. In the Gospel of John, chapter 17, Jesus himself prays to God, prays to his Father, and he says, he asks that everyone would be completely one. Completely one, so that no one in the world may know that you have sent me and that you have loved them even more than you have loved me. Think of this. When Jesus was asked that very poignant question by his disciples, they asked him, so, Jesus, how do we pray? What did Jesus answer them? He said, pray this way. Our Father. Our Father. He didn't say my Father. He said, our Father. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive others. Don't bring us into a time of temptation, but deliver us. It's not a prayer of me, myself, and I. It's a prayer of unity. It's a prayer of family together with very strong bonds. Jesus prays for unity in the family. I believe we need to demonstrate this unity. We need to be the people in the world that people see unity. We need to practice unity in this world. We need to practice so much that we simply can't resist it. It needs to become part of our habits to be unified as brothers and sisters in Christ. I don't think Paul was just speaking to the church of Galatia, and I don't think he's speaking to just the Good Shepherd Church. But I think sometimes we get together and we think, well, maybe God was just speaking to the Methodists of New Jersey. Wasn't he? He's speaking to the whole globe. All the people around the globe, all humanity who believe that Jesus Christ is their Lord and Savior, can now receive the greatest gift ever given through their baptism. The old laws are gone. There's a whole new life and a whole new faith that we've been called into. But we can't forget about it. We need to live into it. Into Christ. And so I ask you, whose are you? Who do you belong to? This sense of allegiance to a family is a very powerful theme. It's the theme that kind of runs a TV show called Game of Thrones. Have you ever heard of that? Game of Thrones. It's all about different families and their power struggles and their regions in the medieval times. One of the famous families part of this TV show is called the Stark family, of which I don't think I'm any relation. But the Stark family is a struggling family. They're always the underdogs. They struggle with the weather and the temperature and all the battles and all the things that life keeps showing at them. They constantly show up as the underdog, kind of like our Eagles this week, right? But each and every time someone from the family falls down, gets hurt, has a down day, every time someone in that Stark family has a problem, another family member shows up and says, look at me. You are Stark. And that points to something different, doesn't it? It points to something greater, something more powerful, something better than anything you're currently experiencing, something that will get you through thick and thin. Look at me. You are a Christian. You are loved by God. You are part of Christ's family. Look at me. You are a Christian. And that allegiance that we have to our family changes us. Our life becomes different. And we grow together, not apart. We don't separate ourselves. We pull ourselves together. And when one is hurting, we all jump in. And And when one is celebrating, we all celebrate. Our words, our actions, and our thoughts should no longer divide us. Because you are baptized in Christ. Into Christ. Christ is not baptized into you. Which means Christ is not yours, you are Christ's. And as we are all now Christ, we are all part of that one family. Brothers and sisters, no tighter bond can ever be broken. Look at me. You.